Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being patient with us. We've had some technical difficulties, but we should be up and running now. No matter what, though, our God is great. He is faithful, and we are here to worship him. So you could rise up here in this house, and wherever you're at, wherever you're connecting with us, Facebook, YouTube, whichever, God is in control, and he loves you, and so do we. Amen, amen. All right, God. We just lift up our hands and surrender. We open up our hearts. We open up our minds, our souls, God, to just be renewed, refreshed, and surrendered to you this morning. You are mighty, and you hold us in your mighty hands, God, and we love you so much, and we just love you and honor you and give you all the glory. Amen.
I was lost in shame, could not get past my blame till he called my changed me, darkness held me down, but Jesus pulled me out. I'm no longer bound. I'm so glad he saved me. Now a new creation in Christ.
Amen.
The old is gone, there's new life. I live by faith, not by sight. There is a new
we are. and that are precious. Precious. We are precious in His sight, and we are believing for more because that is who our God is, and He will never fail. Amen.
Wait. promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You'll never fail again, 'cause your promise still stands.
Down. praise Him, Lord. Praise Him, Lord. Can you praise the Lord?
Lord, You're so thank good you, to us, Jesus.
Just thank Him.
You never leave so us. Good. You never forsake us.
He's brought us so far.
Oh, yes. New creatures in Christ. So new identity. Oh, Jesus.
Own it this morning. Own the change. You're not who you were.
make a dead man walk again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live, gonna open the grave. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. Cause this is the sound of dry bones rattling.
Alright, let's echo this together.
Speak to it.
Live, live.
Come on, you
that rose Jesus and Lazarus from the grave is alive in us today. Hallelujah. We can speak to those things, although they were dead, and bring them to life. Because faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Hallelujah. So, Father, we put our trust, our hope, we cast our cares upon you. For, Father, you're the great physician, the great I am. There's nothing impossible, nothing too hard for you. Hallelujah. Father, we speak to those dead things and say, live in Jesus' name. Live in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I speak healing over each and every person in the sound of my voice. Lord, emotional healing, physical healing, mental healing, dear Father, bring that to each and every person here today, God, as we put our trust, our faith, our hope in you, the great Redeemer. We bless you, God. We pray your kingdom come and your will be done here in our lives as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Come on and give him some praise again. Come on, praise him like he's here. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Bless you, Lord. You may be seated.
All right, that should work, sorry. Real quick, because we want to make sure everybody gets a chance to go where they get to go, and so, especially our children. So just so you know, there is care from birth to sixth grade, right, that we have. And so Julie is one of our children's directors, and so if it's possible, I don't see her, but she might have already left out the door. But she would like you to check in if you're bringing a new kid to her, and definitely you want to connect with her. She's right around that corner outside the doors there, so make sure you do that. We're going to go to our video announcements now, and then we'll come back.
All right.
Please see Pastor Guy Parker or Julie Manette.
Crossroads Youth Ministry meets on Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. If you have any questions, please see Renee Carrick or Natalie Popke. If you would like to be a part of the greeters or the ushers team, please see Pastor Guy Parker. Calling all cards, we need some major help in our children's ministry. From our nursery to our toddlers to our elementary students, we need more workers. If you would like to be willing to get involved, please see Joe Bosca or Julie Manette. For the summer months, we will not be meeting regularly on Wednesday night. Instead, we will be having a gathering in July and August. We will be meeting on the dates of July 13th and August 24th at 7 p.m. Be on the lookout for our next VIP month in August. The theme for that month will be centered around the theme of this year's VBS, which is the power of God. So mark your calendars for Monday, August 8th, Tuesday, August 9th, and Wednesday, August 10th. Definitely be looking forward to be hearing more about a Rocky Road VBS experience in the months to come. We are raising funds to be prepared to either expand our current building or to move to a new place with more space. Please consider giving towards the Dream Big Fund and expand our territory. Also, don't forget to be rejoicing over the ways God has already shown his great favor.
Let's fulfill our mission to reach through honor, impact with authenticity, decide through relationship, and engage with passion. Enjoy the ride.
Amen, amen. Good stuff. We've had a little bit of technology issues today. John has done a great job of being Johnny on the spot, if that makes any sense. So, good job, buddy. Thank you. I'm going to invite Stephanie to come share. and she's going to share some things about our women's ministry and what's happening there. So, good stuff.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Stephanie. I'm part of the women's ministry here, and next week is our deadline for your first deposit of $100 for the women's retreat. It's October 21st to the 23rd. We will be having a guest speaker, games, food, fun, prizes. We would like you to all come and join us. If there's some reason that you can't work it out financially, please see us so we can try to help you out. Also, if you have any questions about the event, you can see me after church, like any more details that you may need. Please be encouraged and please try your best to be there because it's going to be a great event. Thank you so much.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Steph. So I want to bring up something that we need to be mindful of, too, is so Pastor Tom and Gina, as we mentioned last week and had a chance to celebrate them a little bit, but we definitely want to continue to honor them. And one way we're going to honor them is through a love offering. So in these next 2 weeks, if you grab one of our envelopes for giving, we just want you to designate Tom, Pastor Tom and Gina, okay? And we'll get that money to them, but that's very important. We're grateful. They came during the toughest season, I think, of ever of ministry, right in the midst of COVID, and have been so faithful. So we really, really could not thank God more for them. And so please be prayerful and definitely generous as you can be, okay? The other thing is, it was mentioned, but I always like to mention that VBS is coming up. Be paying attention. There's dates for different places of work that's going to happen, whether it's decorating the building, etc. That is also VIP month, and so we will be going through a series about the power of God. I'll be doing a sermon, I know, on the power of God through testimony. And so there will be plenty of awesome opportunities that first week. Remember, we take care of our VIPs, so our VIPs are our guests, and we're so grateful anytime we have a chance to spend time with new people and get to know their story. And so that's our way of making impact and reaching through honor. So there will be a gift on that first Sunday of August, and everybody gets that. We just tend to honor everybody, so that's how we do that. But okay, so that's the big things. I will say this before I pray. We have a special treat today, and Pastor Tom's gonna actually stay there, and then he's gonna share a little bit about one of his heroes of the faith. So that's gonna be good stuff. But let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we can't thank you enough for your goodness, God. God, the many, many times, Father, your great faithfulness has showed up in our lives. We are not deserving, but we are so appreciative, God, that you chose us, that you chose us, that you said for the joy set before you, you would endure the cross, God. It's our great privilege to come and to honor you through tithes and offerings, God. God, it is our heart's desire to be principally led by your scripture, God. What you have shared with us in the word is very much what we need to apply to our life every day, God. And we thank you, Lord, that, Lord, although it's fun to be happy, and in a moment it's good to be happy, we thank you that you've given us something so much more in joy, God. And it is your joy that sustains us. It's your joy that brings ultimate fulfillment, God. And so we're so grateful that we can be joyful and cheerful givers to you, God. And we ask, Lord, that you would bless these givings, these tithes and offerings, to further your kingdom, God. It's our heart's desire to see people come to know you, Father. Lord, the pain inside of our hearts when we feel so empty, God, we know that the solution to that pain is you and you alone, God. And so thank you for this day. Ask that you bless Dr. Gardner as he shares today, God. Give him the words that you would want us to hear, God. May your spirit speak through him. And thank you in advance for all that you're going to do. In your mighty name I pray, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. How many's doing well this morning? my nephew Noah requested that we do this song today. And so, how many know that we need life everlasting? Amen. A man who has been doing ministry longer than I have been alive. He has just a gift to dive into the Word. And, you know, if you've never had a five-course meal before, get ready, because this man just knows how to fillet the Word and just bring it in such a way that it will bring life to you. You know, I like to liken what he shares with us as if a roller coaster ride. My family were at Cedar Point this past weekend, and you know, on a roller coaster, the roller coaster starts going up, and you feel it click into that track, and it's making its way up, and it's the setup for the big reveal. And our beloved Dr. Leonard Gardner here does that setup. And then when the revelations start kicking in, you're on a roller coaster ride, and it's just a wonderful experience to be able to sit under his ministry today. So let's give him a hand, amen, and thank him for being with us today at the Life Church. Amen. Amen. Pastor Larry, his mic.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Amen, amen, amen. I don't think I deserve that kind of an introduction. But since I have the microphone now, you can give God all the praise and all the glory. That's why we're here. He is a mighty God. There's none like him. None that'll ever be like him. None that'll ever be greater than him. I'm so thankful for the opportunity to be with you today. I can tell already at least some of you are saved in this place. Hallelujah. You got a little life, a little joy, a little happiness. I love that very much. That sounds like victory to me. And that's a sound of our Lord. It's a good God. Hallelujah. As my brother said a few moments ago, it has been a long time that I've been serving the Lord. I don't know if I shared any part of my testimony the last time I was here. I just felt to do that a little bit this morning. And this is the second time you've heard it, just act like it's the first time and get excited. And because each of us are unique. We're here because of Jesus, folks, not the world. The world messes up everything God made. But we have a God that fixes up what can't be messed up. And we're on the fixing up road, I believe. Hallelujah to Jesus forevermore. I was just 2 years old when I first met the Lord. You say, how did you recognize him? Well, I was the firstborn in my family. My mother and dad had been churchgoers for a number of years, but they really didn't know Jesus. And when I was about 2 years old, I came down with double pneumonia. The doctor told them after he'd work with me for a while, and he brought in two other specialists, that there was no hope that I was ever going to live. I had double pneumonia. It was, and at that time, there was no such thing as penicillin. There was no such thing as some of the medications that are commonly used in this day. But there was Jesus. He's always been here and always been ready. And he made no mistake. And so my parents became somewhat anxious with that kind of a description of my situation. They were told by these three doctors to prepare my funeral, just to go to the funeral home and get everything organized, because I wouldn't I wouldn't be living. Well, you know, if you're young, newly married couple, you don't like that information, and you don't like that direction. And they didn't either. So, but they didn't know what to do because they didn't know Jesus. And that made all the difference in the world. It didn't limit what God wanted to do, but it hindered their readability in receiving that. And so they went up to the local stores right near where we lived, and was in the downtown Detroit area. And they got hold of a newspaper, and they saw a little advertisement in that paper of a church that believed in divine healing. And they'd never seen that, and they didn't know what that was all about. But when you're standing right at the brink of going to a funeral, you'll welcome any kind of a difference. And so they took me to this little church that was described in this advertisement. And there, the pastor just had prayer for me. He said, we're not going to believe for death, we're going to believe for life. I couldn't say amen, I wasn't that old, but I was certainly good to hear. And so he laid hands on me and prayed, and God immediately reversed that situation. And I've never had pneumonia again. I've never really even been very sick. And just about a month ago, I celebrated my 89th birthday. But God, I don't care what your situation is, always end it with, but God. Because He has a word, He has a work, He has a purpose, He has a plan. We're not born by accident. We're born in God's time to do God's will and to see His purpose fulfilled through our lives. Well, I knew nothing about Christianity, of course, but I've been changed, and I knew my life was going to be different. I started preaching really early. I was probably around 4 years old when I got my teddy bear. And nobody taught me this, but I put him in my little rocking chair, and I'd preach to him. You know, I kind of fell in love with preaching a little bit. So I just shared the only thing I knew. Most of what I knew was all about Jesus. And that's really the story of it all. That's the point of it all. And so, one thing I fell in love with preaching at that time, because I noted that no one in my little congregation, usually a one or two, had ever had any exposure to that. Well, the Lord is so faithful and so good, you know. But I never had anybody walk out on me. Nobody ever came in late. And my teddy bear was always smiling even when I got done. And I thought, this preaching stuff isn't bad, you know. It's a way to live. But just to make a long story short, and it's been filled with many, 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 many victories. As I sit before you this morning, I give all the praise and honor to Jesus. I believe He has charted the path. I don't know why he chose me. I'm very glad he did. I wouldn't have had it any other way. But he's the wonderful, indescribable, mighty, almighty God. No one like him. No one will ever be like him. And he has the whole world in his hands this morning. Don't go home and listen to everything you hear on the 6 o'clock news. I got some news here. And this little book, that's the real story of it all. And there's one on the throne this morning. And he just doesn't belong to a political party. He belongs to his Father, the creator of everything that is. And he hasn't moved off. And he's not about to step down. But he's gathering together, I believe, a group of people in this day that are going to be anointed and used in a mighty way like you've never seen before in history. I believe with all my heart there is a move of God on the horizon that's going to trigger this end time. Oh yeah, sure he's coming again for his people, but there's going to be thousands of people that are going to see the light instead of living in the darkness. Walking away where there's joy and peace, like we've sang about this morning, and never, never are disappointed when you live for Jesus. And one of the things I feel that God has laid on my heart in this last day is to preach to people that need to be prepared to be used by him in this last hour. Now I know there's the message of being prepared to go, but I want to talk to you a little bit this morning about being prepared to stay for a while, because it's not all over yet. There are thousands and thousands of people that haven't yet heard the word of God. Can you imagine how heaven must have reacted when the time came for Jesus, the Son of God, to be born? When they knew that this one that had been prophesied about, had been spoken of, had been prepared for, was about to step onto this earth and do the work that no one else could ever do. And he brought with him that great redemption story, that work of wellness that no sickness or death can defy. He's a mighty God, folks. He's a mighty God, mighty God. Over 6,900 times in the scripture, he's called Jehovah, or Jehovah with a suffix. And he can only be described as indescribable, mighty as the mightiest of the mighty. There's no one like him. But I believe that he is calling people in this hour. Many of you sitting in here this morning will hear his call if you listen carefully, if you seek him with your whole heart, if you be found faithful to do what he's given you to do. Life has only begun. The greater things are yet ahead. I believe that with all of my heart. I don't know how long I'd be here, but I remember preaching a conference down in Alabama some number of years ago. And then when I was in prayer the morning before the evening service, the Lord opened to me that I was going to be around for a while. I was ready to go. Everything I've heard about what it's like over there made me even more anxious. But you know something? Until the time comes, we have a very important work to do here. And in that morning, I was able, as he spoke Psalm 71 to me, Psalm 71, read it when you get home, about what God will do in your life, he has his hand upon. And I believe there are people in here this morning that God is in the preparation of getting ready to be a part of this end time move of God. When he came the first time, he came without one disciple, without one follower, without one giver. He was the gift that came from Father. And when he stepped onto this earth, he became the answer to the thing that mankind needed since the fall, the beginning of the days, when Adam and Eve disobeyed God and the horribleness of sin and darkness invaded this earth. The few years that I've lived, I can't believe how sick this world has become. I'm going to tell you it like it is. I've been around for a while. And we have taken some of the great things that God has given us and absolutely ruined them, destroyed them. There's no hope in the world other than Christ. And I believe that he died not only for us that are born again, but he died for those that yet do not know him. And if you have unsaved loved ones, relatives, or whatever, just keep praying, keep believing. But let God touch your heart with the calling. See, before he left this earth to return home for a season to be with Father, he called his disciples together. And he said to them, go ye into all the world. In Mark, in Matthew, he said, go to all nations and teach them, preach to them the kingdom of God. Go ye, go ye, go ye. You know, I think sometimes we have it mixed up, because most of the time we're saying, come ye. Come ye to us. You know, we have more beauty in our sanctuary, or we have more joy. No. The joy, the hope of all the world is in Jesus. And when we obey him and follow him, we'll be a part of this end time move of God. I believe for that. I've seen hundreds and hundreds, even thousands of souls saved. I've seen people heal. I've seen the deaf begin to hear and the blind begin to see. But it's not the end. It was just an introduction to what's ahead of us. So I want to talk to you this morning about being ready to be used of God in a new way in these last days. How many of you would like your life to end that way? Anybody? Oh, thank you for coming today. You too. See, that's what it's all about. If we don't get that focus, we don't get that understanding, then life can seem like vanity. No purpose. Nothing important. Yet we've been born as God has directed, and born again if you're a Christian this morning, and being led by his Spirit to be prepared to be a vessel in his honor. I think of the first time Jesus came. You know, when he was born here in this earth, he didn't have any disciples. He didn't have any followers. He was the babe that came to redeem the world. But then, as he began to prepare at 30 years to move into ministry, he drew from the roots of his Jewish training, and then he began to prepare for ministry. He acknowledged when he was only 12 that his real father was the one in heaven that he had just left. And then as he moved into his ministry, God began to show him those that were called to walk with him. Did you ever wonder how Jesus was led to choose Peter, James, and John, and Bartholomew, Matthew, Philip? Did you ever wonder what led him to pick them? Because it's the same today with you. What leads him? What catches his eye? What's important about our lives that he would choose us and say, come on, become yoked with me, because we're going to finish the work that I've started. And I want to take you through some scripture that gives us the answer to that this morning. If you have your Bibles, I would invite you to open them with me to Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. You know, if I were to illustrate, in fact, all of those that were, I'll say, on the Jesus team, that his inner circle, his disciples, you'll know that even though he came and he died for the world, he was going to flow this message down through 12 men that he chose to be yoked with him and walk with him. If you know anything about the Jewish way, the acknowledged teacher among the Jews was called the rabbi. Rabbi, R-A-B-B-I. Now, a rabbi was a person that had been acknowledged and proven to be a teacher. Comes from the root word R-A-B, or Rab. So Rabs were people that were set aside to become rabbis, chosen to be a teacher. And then out of that, you know, came the hierarchy of Rabboni, which is adding a suffix of O-N-I to it. And Mary Magdalene at the resurrection in the garden, the resurrection of Jesus, called him that very word, Rabboni. And she was touching the heart of God. Because the word rab means teacher. The word rabbi means a special, choice, proven teacher. Jesus was a rabbi in the Jewish faith. And the word Rabboni is the one that really touches your heart. It means my teacher. So Jesus isn't just a teacher. He's not just the teacher. He's my teacher. And there has to be a linking, you see, between the follower and the teacher. How did he choose the men he chose to follow him? Let's take a quick look. There are so many ways I could go this morning, and I just want God by his Spirit to stir our hearts. If you're not hungry for God, for more of God, I want to make you hungry. And if I can't do that, we'll just keep preaching till it's afternoon hour and you'll get hungry. Matthew chapter 4 in your Bible. Open it with me. It's all there. We know the answer to that question. Because if I took all 12 of these men that he chose, there are three of the 12 that we call the inner circle. Think of an illustration like a target that is a series of concentric circles. The circle gets bigger and bigger as you go further from the center. And so that right in the center is called the target itself. The special, if you're good at archery, you can hit the target every time. Most of us can't claim that kind of ability. But if I look at the 12 disciples that Jesus gathered, every one of them had a special calling and a special gift, just like you do in your life. God has given you certain abilities and talents, part of which come to you from a genetic standpoint. Some of the things that were in your background have been passed down to you. But the other part that is so dramatically important is when you come to Christ and you dedicate yourself and you get yoked with him, he deposits certain other giftings in us. And those are the things that are important to people that are used in special ways by God. So I've always been interested in what is it that you saw, Lord? Why did you pick a guy like Peter? If you're familiar with your Bible, you'll know with me that he certainly knew how to make mistakes. He knew how to speak at the wrong time. He knew how to say things that wouldn't make anybody popular. But he seemed to become at the center, the core, maybe the man that needed the deeper touch by Jesus, became almost like an unannounced leader among the 12. So the three that were considered inner circle of the 12, help me, or not only Peter, John, and James. John and James were brothers. Peter was the younger brother of Andrew. Andrew was a man that knew Jesus, actually came to Jesus before Peter did. But he never, ever became part of the inner circle. But here in Matthew chapter 4, we see something that I want you to remember, because it's an important part of God's hand upon your life. How many of you have ever wanted or ever prayed to be used in a greater way by God? Hold your hand up. Don't be ashamed of it. He can see. There's a hunger down in your heart. Say, Lord, I want more of you. I want more than I've ever had. I want you to use me, Lord. You may have relatives that aren't even saved yet. Maybe your parents, maybe your brothers or sisters that don't know Jesus. Oh God, I've seen this thing in my years in walking with God, where God will just save one, and through that one save the whole family. I received a telephone call not long ago from a lady down in Tennessee. The head of a television studio, who told me her story. I never realized it. Those of you that know some of our past know that we've had some relatively large congregations, and So I didn't know a lot of these things, and said, unless people contact me personally. And she told me the first time she came to our church, the first message she heard was when I preached from the Psalm, which said that we can trust God to bring our whole family to Him if we walk with Him and obey Him all the days of our lives. She said, I'm just calling you, Pastor Gardner, to tell you. You haven't seen me in years. You don't know much about me. She said, I was the only one in my family that was saved. Just a young girl, about 12, 13 years old. She was so young that one of her friends brought her to church for the first time. Her mother and dad wasn't saved. They wouldn't even take her to church. They didn't want any part of it. But when she heard that message that morning, she dedicated her life to the Lord, and she said, Jesus, if you'll save my family, I'll serve you for my whole life. She called to tell me she was not only walking as a Christian, having the very responsible position she was holding, but she said, I want to tell you something. I got hold of that scripture that you preached on that Sunday morning. And she said that as of now, my whole family, from the youngest to the oldest, including my grandfather, who was a dedicated atheist, have all been born again and are all walking with Jesus. The whole family. And that's not unique. That's one of several testimonies like that. I'm just saying to you, nothing is too hard for God. If we live our life for God and do what He calls us to do, only He can define and total the great things that He has in store. And so in her particular case, like the case of many others, we rejoice to see what God has done and will still do as we walk with Him. Now in Matthew, I'm going to chapter 4, if you want to follow with me, and see where Jesus made this first choice. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 18. Follow me now carefully. We must read the Word of God. Every single word is important in the Word of God. No word is a filler like it is in our language. This says, and Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, He's now about 30 years old. He's ready to move into His ministry. And He walks by the Sea of Galilee. He saw two brothers. One was called Peter, and one was called Andrew, his younger brother. What did he see? He saw him casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. You see in the pattern normally in the Hebrew household was that the household would identify with a certain occupation and they would all participate that way. In this particular case, the sons of Zebedee and Andrew and Peter were disciples. Who became disciples, rather, of Jesus, came from a family that were fishermen. That was their living. That was the way they had grown to this point. And so Jesus, the scripture says, when he walked by, Peter that day. Do you see the word saw? Saw, do you see that in the verse I read? Anybody? Oh, thank you. Saw. What caught his eye? What was the thing that was so important to Jesus that he would call for this man and say, come and follow me? Change your life. You're not to continue to be a great fisherman of fish. I'm going to make you a fisherman of men. And Peter, he saw Peter casting his net. Now you remember in that day, this was the normal way that fishermen would fulfill their responsibility. They didn't fish with a hook and a line and a worm hanging on the end. They fished with a net. They threw the net out into the water, dragged it in, and if they were successful, the net was filled with fish. They would empty it out, and they would have the compensation for their occupation of that day. So this caught the eye of Jesus. I was reading this and I thought, Lord, what was it that caused you to look at Peter and say, I know he's going to be a special man that's going to work with me? It tells us right here, but we have a tendency to read over top of some words. One here in this case is saw. His eyes were focused on Peter. And he was saying, in effect, I want that kind of a guy to be part of my team. I want him to be part of those that I will call to work with me to do the job. After he saw him casting the net, he didn't just see him owning a net or admiring a net or comparing his net with somebody else's net. The word casting means he was actively fishing. To be a caster. Jesus was looking for somebody that had that desire within them to cast the net and bring in the fish. That singled him out, I believe, as one of the inner circle men. In spite of all the mistakes, all the shortcomings, all the things that he did wrong, are you glad that Jesus didn't just pick perfect people? If he did, we wouldn't be here. So he isn't impressed by what we do wrong. He is impressed by what consumes our desire, what we're doing in effect that he can use in his kingdom. So he called Peter and he said, follow me. That's what a rabbi would do in those days. He would collect his own number of people. Normally, a rabbi would gather about 5 people. Jesus gathered 12 because his work, the work that he needed to do, required that many more to spread the good news of the kingdom after he arose from the dead. But he saw in Peter a desire, a practice, a hunger to cast what he had and to bring it in. And it always brought a good number of fish. What a wonderful thing. because he was occupied with something that was meaningful and could be used in the kingdom of God. He was a net caster. I believe it pleases the heart of God when we find ourselves going about our daily life and encountering people in places we may never have expected, or coming in contact with even people that are related to us in the natural, but we're always ready to cast our net, to talk about Jesus, to give testimony to what he has done, to acknowledge that he was the one that made me what I am. He's the one that took me from this loser to be part of the winning team. I can think of no greater pleasure in all the world than to live your life for Jesus. You have many opportunities. In my particular case, as I was growing, I was given a 4-year scholarship to study dentistry at the University of Michigan. After much prayer, I made the decision not to go that route, but to give my life to Jesus. I've never been sorry. I told the folks of the church that I pastored, I thought I would be in their mouth, and God put me in your face. He knows what he wants to do with all of us, but it's most likely that where we are today is not where he's going to take us. We're just on the road. As we link, he used the word yoke. He called and he says, come, follow me. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. I don't say he won't have hard places. I'll never say there's not difficulties along the way. I will say you'll always come out the winner. You'll never, never, ever regret every decision you made for Jesus. When he comes passing through your life in a special way, with a special anointing to help you to fulfill that need he has in bringing in the harvest in this last day, I believe there are many people he anoints in a special way. He takes people that are not perhaps known for what they are, but are willing to become everything he wants them to be. So he chose Peter. Peter became one of the inner circle. Now turn over to the gospel according to, before we turn there, let's just go down to verse 21, which is a part of the same chapter. It says, and Jesus went on from thence. When he went on, he what? Say it again.
Saw.
What? Say it again.
Saw.
There's that same word. What caught his attention? Why did he make the decision? I want this man as part of my team to bring in the harvest. Well, the interesting thing, he goes on to say that he was one of two men, one called James and one called John. And they were with their father Zebedee, and they were mending their nets. See, Peter was a caster. These men were menders. All part of the necessary work to prepare them to receive and not lose any of the fish, any of the people, not lose any that are called to follow Jesus. They were faithful. Jesus saw in them the fact that they not only owned a net and realized it, but they mended it. How did it become broken and torn? Well, it's very simple. If you're ever exposed to fishing with a net, and that is there's all kinds of trash at the bottom of the water. When you drag that net in over, you retrieve it. It encounters stones, encounters broken glass, all kinds of things that can tear and rip at a net. So if you're going to keep on being effective in serving the Lord, I like Peter and John's approach. That was, they sewed up the holes. They didn't throw the net away. They sewed up the holes. And I can see in the heart of Jesus a feeling that, you know, we're going to encounter people as we minister who are torn, who are broken, who think their life is over, who think they can't be useful in any way to bring in the lost or touch the one that is in need. But rather than throw the net away and say, I'm just going to quit and go do something else, we get out the needle and thread. I call them the needle and thread men, because they see in the broken life the potential of being whole once again. See, all of us were broken somewhere in the past. We all came short of the glory of God. There's none of us who are perfect. Somebody or somebody's, plural, came along and sewed up and continued to sew up every place that our net was torn. We got discouraged here. We got upset here. We got a loss of vision and what we ought to be doing. There's all kinds of mistakes that we can make, but the thing he saw in James and John were people that didn't, that weren't quick to throw torn nets into the trash. They were quick to pull out the needle and thread and to patch them up. We meet those kind of people. That's what life is all about. It's all about, come in, let me love you. Let me show you the better way. I didn't come to condemn you. I came to give you life and that more abundantly. I didn't come to destroy you. I came to heal you, that you might be whole in every way. So I can see in Jesus, when he saw these men out there mending their nets, thinking, I can use those kind of men. I can use people that don't think that any net is torn so badly that it can never be healed and be useful again. That's the kind of men I want on my team. You see, if we don't have this kind of vision, we'll have trouble functioning in this kind of a world. Because I do believe, as I said earlier, that this world is getting worse and worse and worse and worse. I can get trouble, difficulty, even hearing the 6 o'clock news sometimes. I turned it off. I don't want to hear that junk. They're trying to take our little children and teach them things that their poor little fresh minds can't comprehend. Choose what you want to be, a boy or a girl. No. My God made that choice. He's the one who made that decision. Don't confuse me with all of that garbage. Or do we understand that his way is the only way, it's the best way? And so we become net menders, net menders. If you serve God for any length of time, you'll soon recognize that. There's some place, even if it's a place that you think isn't important, that you can be of service to the King. That your pastor can help you to link, to make yoke with Jesus, and let him make a healer out of you, to see people function once again, and to know that Jesus doesn't consider any of us trash. We're not trash. We may have acted that way at times, but that's not what we are. Hallelujah. And then there was one more. Because we've talked about Peter, we've talked about James and John. But there's one more situation, and I'll close with this. If you want to turn to chapter 5 of Luke in your Bible, where you see that he picked another man because he saw something in that man. And that's what he does with us. Chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. It came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw. If you're a Bible marker, underline those words. They're so important. What did he see? Saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them, and they were washing their nets. So he saw net casters, he saw net menders, and he saw net washers. What are net washers? They are people that have to inspect their own condition. The net gets too heavy to cast if you don't take the junk out of it from the last trip. Well, you're quiet. Think about it. It can only be useful. It can only be cast if it's clean. It can't be overloaded with problems and troubles. Say, well, I'd really like to work for the Lord, but I just can't get up in the morning. 10:30, that's early for a Sunday. That's not, nothing's early if it's God's time. It's opportunity, it's not obligation. It's privilege, it's not punishment. And so there's a need, there's a constant need, even in the lives of people that are used of God continually. We all have to wash our own nets, because the devil is a tricky monster. Somebody come along and, you know, I used to have a thing in church I pastored for a while where people would want to see me before a service. I had a rule, I would not see anybody before a service. So I learned something. In many cases, they didn't have good reason to see me. They came that Sunday morning because they were mad at something and they wanted to tell me that they were quitting. That was the last Sunday they were going to be there. Well, I sure didn't need that dumped on me 5 minutes before church was going to start. You know, Pastor, how the enemy can drill you with that. So I just wouldn't talk to him. If you wanted to tell me that, you have to show up on my time. Because, you see, we're so self-serving by nature. Hello? Maybe nobody is down here where you live. I, They are out where I live. I found out there's quite a few self-serving people. And so you gotta wash your net. You gotta wash your net, even if you're working for Jesus. I would venture to say you could talk to your pastor, get him all alone, ask him if he's ever had to wash his net. He'll not only tell you yes, he'll maybe tell you the number of times he's had to do it. But I found that it's so important when Jesus sees somebody that's concerned with washing, getting the junk out of it before going out to fish for another day. Because we accumulate junk. True? Thank you for coming. Somebody. We accumulate garbage. Weaving of the cords together that make the net will catch and attract junk. The devil is standing there to throw something in there, make your net too heavy, make your net too difficult, too demanding. Well, I would do that, but and they want you to do more. Well, if it's needed, it's needed. We learn to be prepared as God moves us on and upward. Let me shatter the faith of a lot of people in saying that it doesn't get easier as you go up the ladder. We become more dangerous. The devil has more to throw at us. But our God is faithful. So when he saw a couple of people that, a couple of men here were more interested in having a clean net because they're looking at the next cast. They're not thinking of the last one. They're looking at the next one. And I want to be ready to get every single fish that I can get. Okay, so you can see on these three verses, all of these three men, all of them were doing something that caught the eye of Jesus. He saw they were casting a net. He saw that they were mending a torn net. And he saw that they were washing an unclean net. And you know, it's interesting if you follow that story all the way through the Gospels. And I'll close with this. He took that inner circle to three places that the other nine, and later the other eight, couldn't go. He took them first I'll give you all three. He took the ones that had to go through something to get to the next level. The people that he took to the Garden of Gethsemane were only three that he took to the inside. The others were out on the outskirts praying and sleeping. But they were three that knew prayer was going to be vital in getting the job done. And the other thing, he took all three to the mountain on which the man of God, Jairus, who was a rabbi in the synagogue, his daughter was dying and died. He took him to there to see not only the prayer, importance of prayer, but the importance of power as he raised that little girl from the dead. See, in every single case, every case, the place of prayer, the place of power, and the place of praise when he took them to the high mountain. And Elijah appeared on one side, Jesus appeared on the other side. Or Moses, rather, I'm sorry, appeared on the other side. Jesus greater than the law and the prophets. And so there, they become prepared so that after Jesus would die and ascend, they could continue on. They had known the yoking with Jesus. They had seen the power. They'd heard the prayer. They had been able to entertain the praise that came from them. So Jesus said, that's the ones I want. You netcaster, come on, follow me. You netmender? Oh, I got a lot of things for you to do. Come on, follow me. You net washer? Oh, you wash your net before you get? I want you, come on, get up front here. You see, it's all in preparation to get the job done. Jesus knew what the job was going to be. They didn't. But he saw in them. He saw in them the desire to do it right, to do it that way. Sometimes we look in the mirror and we see all of our weaknesses. And sin that can often be redemptive because we know how badly we need the Lord to be complete and to be whole. But not important when it brings discouragement, heartache, people giving up. I'm not giving up on America. I got three more that haven't either. Then don't listen to the news tonight. Because our charge, our call, is to do something about the mess. We're called to be fishers of men. And you might be going about your life and you'll feel that special tug of Jesus on your heart. Come follow me. Oh, I don't know. I've seen the torn nets. I've seen the dirty nets. I've seen those that don't even cast their net. They just advertise the fact that they have one. I won't continue on that thought. But it's true. But you and I are in a day, a choice day, a great day, a wonderful day. Well, all we need to do is yield the talents, the abilities, the skills that we already have, that he already gave us to him. And his anointing touch will make it powerful. We'll raise the dead. It'll heal the sick. It'll save the lost. It's more than enough. So if anybody asks you what you're doing as you travel along, just tell them I'm just following the king's orders. And if he says cast the net, I'm going to cast the net. May not be popular. Somebody may get upset because they say, oh, well, all I ever get from you is you wanted me to join your church. No, we don't want you to join your church. We want you to join, yoke up with Jesus. He's the one that has all the answers. Amen. 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 don't hesitate to mark your Bibles wherever you see the word saw. I said, I when the Lord showed that to me, I said, I understand, Jesus. I want to be moved by what moves you. You know, if you're going for a job, you want to be seen in all your beauty. You don't show all your ugliness. You don't show every mistake you ever made. It was yesterday. We're living today and tomorrow. So this is a privilege we have. And I want to challenge you. Get behind your pastor. Get behind the leaders in this church. Lend your abilities, your strength. You say, but I'm not perfect. None of us are. I'm not saying Jesus looked and he saw a man that was perfect. Doesn't say that, does it? He just saw a man that was moved by the need to cast for that fish or he'll be lost. By the need to mend that net or I'll never catch that fish. And by the need to wash my own net or I have no power and no strength to do anything. Thank God. Let's pray, shall we, this morning. Bow your heads with me. I'm going to close because I always have a problem with closing. Our Father, we open the word this morning before you. You not only spoke it, you not only gave it, you wrote it, Lord. We believe every part of it, even the commas and the exclamation points. And so we're interested that as you were preparing to gather your called out ones, your ecclesia, for your day, we find a pattern that, Lord, we can use in this time of eschatology, a time when it's the nearing the end. We're close to the end. We're pressing upon the end, but it's not over yet, and it won't be done until you say it's over. But Lord, I believe there are talents and abilities and skills in this room right now this morning that you need for the work that you have chosen to do through this life church. Group of perfect people, we'll never find them. If we do, we can't show up anymore because we make it imperfect. So Lord, I just ask you this morning to touch some heart. I sat here this morning and heard the announcement that there's a need for some children's workers. Lord, lay it on somebody's heart this morning. Call that one, Lord, that you see it has love for the little ones. So much love that they would lay aside their own preferred route of just coming and eating. And Lord, I pray that you will meet every need in this church. I pray, God, that you will continue your good work and the part of those that have been called, that have been born to be leaders. I know there's leadership material here, Lord. We've seen you take some of them home over these last few years. People, Lord, that makes us feel a little bit lonely sometimes. but you're not done yet. So I pray that you will help and cause, as we walk through this daily life, our eyes to be drawn to that one, that person that you've chosen to fill that need. Thank you, Lord. We just love you this morning. I pray your blessing upon everyone. I pray the extension of your hand, Lord. Show us the people that really care. Make us one of those people that, like Joshua of old, will stand and say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank God. Thank you for your kindness. Here's another great man of God standing right here.
Thank you. I'll pay you later. A few weeks ago, there was a man that pulled into a California gas station, and his desire was to get gas, and he looked at the pump, and he expected to pay $6.99 per gallon in California. But as he saw, the number, the decimal point had moved over, and it was actually 69 cents. So he began pumping his gas, thinking, oh my gosh, I'm paying 69 cents for premium gas. And he thought, I'll just keep this a secret. He got on social media and told everybody. This glitch that happened cost the gas station $20,000. My point is that he didn't keep the good news to himself. He shared it with others. Are you a net caster today? Are you a net washer? Are you a net mender? And if you need your net mended today, we're here to pray for you and to encourage you today in the Lord. And I want to tell you, you know, I appreciate you, Dr. Gardner, and your ministry. Did anybody get anything out of that today? Amen. Good stuff. I encourage you. He's an author of many books. We got books back there for you. They're $10. I encourage you to pick one up, and I promise you that you will get something out of that book. And here's the guarantee. If you don't, come to me, and I'll buy the book off of you. Okay? So I believe that there's something good in there for you. Let's give him a hand for being a blessing to our ministry. And if you get a chance, when you're thinking about it, go to your prayer closet, lift him up in prayer, pray for his ministry as he continues to move forward for the kingdom of God. Amen? Because the best, he said it out of his own mouth, the best is still yet to come. Amen. And so we thank you all for being here today and being a part of what God is doing. And you know what? God is bringing revival to the Life Church. Get prepared for it. He preached a word today to get that spirit of evangelism in our hearts to prepare for the revival and the growth that's to come. So get ready. Come on, tell your neighbor, get ready. Come on, it's going to happen. Amen. Thank you for coming today. God bless you all. Remember, if you need prayer, come on up. But we'll see you next week. Same time, same station. Enjoy the ride.